Good morning. Thank you for joining us here in St. Austell. My name is Carol Edelson and I'm a curate here at the church. Today we're at the ancient well of Menacuddle, a place where early Christians would gather and where the flowing waters drew people to build, to settle and to live. Here Austell baptised new believers and they came to realise that although water could quench their thirst, the true quenching, the true end to searching, and the beginning of living a transformed life was only possible through the living water, Jesus Christ. The impact of Austell's ministry was so great that our town, and even in the early days, our church, was named after him. And so as we move forward into all God has for us this morning, let us quieten our minds and allow the Holy Spirit to flow through our hearts and our lives. And Father, we just thank you this morning that we are gathered together, and we pray that that same zeal, that same fire from the Holy Spirit would burn within each one of us, so that we too would reach out to our town and our community, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Oh Lord, you're my shepherd. You make me lie in fields of green. You lead me by the still waters. You restore righteousness to me. Though I walk through the valley, I will fear no evil thing, for you are with me, and you comfort me. Surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow wherever I go. Surely
Let us come before God this morning. The scriptures tell us that God searches and knows our hearts. He knows all that separates us from his presence. And he knows the areas that impede the work of his Holy Spirit. So let us ask him to show us where we need forgiveness and where we need to start anew.
This is holy ground. You are holy, you are holy, God. This is holy, this is holy ground.
Father, we are sorry for the times when we mess up, when we say and do the wrong things. Please forgive us in the name of Jesus and give us the strength by your Holy Spirit to lead lives that bless you and bless others. Amen.
Jesus talks with the Samaritan woman, John chapter 4. The Pharisees heard that Jesus was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but the disciples. When the Lord learned of this, he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria, so he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about the sixth hour. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would give you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his flocks and his herds?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw the water." He told her, "Go, call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus declared, "Believe me, woman, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming, and has now come, when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that the Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I who speak to you am he."
Just then his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, "What do you want?" or "Why are you talking with her?" Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Christ?" They came out of the town and made their way towards him. Meanwhile, his disciples urged him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you know nothing about." Then his disciples said to each other, "Could someone have brought him food?" "My food," said Jesus, "is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say, 4 months more and then the harvest? I tell you, open your eyes and look to the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even now the reaper draws his wages. Even now he harvests the crop for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. Thus the saying, 'One sows and another reaps,' is true. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you have reaped the benefits of their labour." Many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony, "He told me everything I ever did." So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 days. And then, because of his words, many more became believers. They said to the woman, "We no longer believe just because of what you said. Now we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Saviour of the world." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So here's a question. Which person has had the greatest influence on your life today? Which person has so influenced you that you are the person you are largely because of their influence? Fascinating to ask that question and think about it. That question is relevant because as Jesus meets the Samaritan woman in John chapter 4, we see that she experiences the impact of meeting the real Jesus. Jesus is returning to Galilee. Here's some background. He's going to Galilee, and to do so, he goes through Samaria. Now, the Samaritan people were the ancient enemies of the Jews, and the reason for this was quite simple, that some 500 years before and then following, they had offered the Greeks bases, their land, to control the Jewish economy and land. So think of NATO bases in Mediterranean islands, and you've got the idea that the Samaritans had given land to the Greeks so that the Jews could be controlled. And ever since then, the Jews had seen the Samaritans as enemies, as people who they despised. And Jesus goes through Samaria and he sits at the well. Now, Samaritan women, and it would be the women in this culture, would go at sunset or sunrise to fill up their water jars. They would go in groups and they would go when it was cooler. What we notice immediately is that it was noon. And so we learn this woman had some things that we can understand. The first was she had things to hide. She came out at a time where there was very few people about. Secondly, she had no friends, or at least no friends with her at that time. She was ostracized. She was a woman who was not well respected by her people. And the other thing is, she was alone to do the work. Usually in groups, there would be women to help other women load these heavy jars and to pull up the heavy buckets. But no, she's on her own, working in the hottest part of the day, and she's ostracized. And so into that situation walks Jesus. In fact, sits Jesus, because he sits on the well, the edge of the well, and he says to her, and we notice these three things. The first thing is he breaks the social taboo by speaking to the woman. So Jewish men did not speak to single women, unmarried women, women they didn't know. And he speaks to her and says, would you give me a drink? The second thing that he asks for is help. By asking for a drink, Jesus becomes the receiver. He doesn't tell her what to do. He's not commanding. He's asking. He asks for help. And in doing so, he becomes the receiver. He puts himself down. He basically becomes the receiver in this conversation, not the commander. And so we see here that what's happening is that Jesus breaks the taboo by speaking to her. He also breaks the taboo of being within 20 feet of her, which was the Jewish law. And he also humbles himself by becoming the receiver. What does this actually mean? What's this teaching us? Well, this early background shows us that actually we are to be lowly. We are to be the receiver rather than always think we're the giver. Just as an illustration, I have a neighbour nearby, and a little while ago, he has all the tools in the world. You know those men who have all the tools for every job? Well, he has all the tools, does John. And I went to him to borrow a particular tool that I don't have. And I could immediately see that our relationship moved to another footing. He knows what I do. He knows that I'm a leader of a church. He knows I'm a Christian. And we can be superior, can't we? We can be supercilious. We can be above things. We know all the answers. We have all the answers. Well, I didn't have the tool I needed, and John did. And when I asked him, he said, yeah, of course, no problem. And in asking, being the receiver, our relationship altered in some way. There was a sense that somehow there was an equalizing going on. There was a man-to-man, human-to-human connection, which is very precious and very important. And I could see afterwards that our relationship had moved to a different level. This is what was happening with this rejected, ostracized, and probably deeply unhappy woman. Jesus was becoming a reality.
Erica, lovely to see you. Thank you for sparing the time to see me and talk to us. And we've been talking about encountering God. And I know you've had some experiences recently where you've really felt God has encountered you and met you. So tell us a bit more. Tell us what's happened.
Well, Howard, nice to see you too. We've all experienced lockdown in the last 4 months. So early on in lockdown, I had quite a significant sort of encounter with God, as you call it. So I was watching the news, as I think a lot of us were avidly watching the news, kind of the latest updates, and it was being broadcast that the Scottish chief medical officer, unfortunately, had been caught. She was a lady who was telling all the Scottish people, stay at home, no unnecessary travel and all of that. And she had been found with somebody taking photos that she'd been to her second home twice. So I was sort of listening to this and rising up with I can't believe she did this. I just remember walking off into my kitchen having a darn good rant because I was kind of in my self-righteous mode of I've been doing everything I can, I've been staying at home, and the person that should be doing that hasn't. And as I'm doing this in the kitchen, I could suddenly was aware of of the Lord's displeasure, and I was kind of like stopped in my tracks. So I basically was like, oh, he's not happy. So I went to my room, and actually I didn't want to be doing something wrong. And I just remember sitting on my bed and being with the Lord and just being sort of like, I think in my mind, I've done nothing wrong, because I was like, well, she's the one that's done something wrong. And I was just, you know, I'm justified in saying what I have. And then I just picked up my Bible, just happened to be like, right, just picked up my Bible, didn't even do it particularly consciously, picked it up, opened it, and a verse just bounced off the page at me. And it just said, I'll just read it, it's from Proverbs 11, and it just says, to set high standards for someone else and then not live up to them yourself is something that God truly hates. And I just in that moment, yeah, just knew the conviction of the Holy Spirit, but in a way that I was like, so I worked through that, and I was like, Lord, I really thought I was okay saying what I did, and obviously I wasn't, and I was being self-righteous. And but it was like that conviction was then followed by something really awesome, which was suddenly an overwhelming sense of God's love for me, in that he knows me, he watches me, he sees me. He's a God that created the universe, yet he's taken the time to father me and parent me. And I suddenly felt so secure in this incredible sense of belonging to the God of the universe, who loves me enough to kind of go, lovely, you're going in that direction, that isn't okay, I'm going to just realign you in this. And he does it in such a beautiful way, in that just kind of unsettled, like, I knew I'd done wrong. But yeah, so it was a beautiful moment of being corrected in a way that I needed, especially at the moment through this time, that my attitude is in the right place, because I think a lot of people are pointing fingers.
Thank you. And is that about you growing? Do you feel, I mean, it's never nice being told off, is it? It's never nice being shown who you really are. Is that a growing experience? Is that something you felt has sort of deepened you?
Yeah, absolutely. So from that point, it really, and it is in love that God does this, isn't it? And I really felt like he's, and it's the same with a parent, when you're parenting a child, you're doing that. I, as a youth worker, I do that with young people, that sometimes you have to kind of address stuff, don't you? Because you don't want them to veer off in that direction, because that isn't actually going to be for their good. So I know it's for my good, and I know it's about maturing me, and it's about the long-term picture, isn't it, of me being all that I can be and being the best version of me, because God is committed to that, and me being Christ-like and actually Jesus being formed in me, because that's beautiful, isn't it?
Yes. Erica, thank you so much. Isn't it wonderful that God's word is alive? So just at that moment, the right word for the right time, you heard it. So thank you so much. And we're really grateful. And what an encouragement.
Thanks, Howard. Nice to see you.
Bye.
The second thing we learn in this passage is that the gift of God is not a book, but a person. The woman has been slightly wrong-footed by Jesus asking her for something, for a drink. She is disturbed by this and confused a little bit. And as the story continues, we see that she chides Jesus. She mocks him and says, well, if you were a real Jew knowing your law, you wouldn't come within 20 feet of me and you certainly wouldn't speak to me. She's on the offensive. Jesus has made himself humble and she's gone in for the kill. But Jesus says to her a quite amazing thing. The woman chides him and says, if you knew, you wouldn't be here. But he says this in verse 10, Jesus answered her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. Now, the gift of God is a critical thing in this story. For the Samaritans, the gift of God was the Torah, the law of Moses. They saw that as God's revelation of himself. For the Jews, the gift of God was the law and the prophets. But what Jesus is saying here is, he personalizes it. If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, puts the two together, you would have asked him. So he attaches himself to the gift of God. And what we see happening in this story is Jesus quite boldly but gently says, he is the gift of God. Jesus is the fulfillment of both the law of Moses and the prophets and the law. Jesus knew that neither of those are the gift of God. The gift of God is not a book, but a person. This is really critical to us. And there's an allusion here to Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 13, where God is spoken of in terms of living water. God is living water to Jeremiah. And so Jesus, who begins as a receiver, now is moving a step closer to being the revealer. He's revealing who God really is. So the gift of God to you today is Jesus. The gift of God is not the Bible, neither is it church, neither is it community. The gift of God, ultimately, is Jesus. This is something that is so important for us to understand. It's not the Bible, it's not the church, it's not religion, it's not worship. First and foremost, it is Jesus. Just think of the Christmas story for a moment. We all know that story. Jesus Christ is born in Bethlehem. The gift of God is a person. The kings bring gold, frankincense, and myrrh, rich things, amazing things, but they are not the gift. Jesus is the gift. Jesus is the baby who becomes the Messiah. And here it is in John 4. He talks to the Samaritan woman who believes that the word of God is the gift of God. And actually Jesus says, no, I'm the word of God in flesh. And this is something key about this passage, that Jesus is moving us to see that a reality, a real relationship is with flesh and blood, with Jesus, not with his book or his church or a religion. Yes, they're like the gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And yes, it's true. The word of God is truth. But he says, no. If you just knew who you were talking to, you would ask him and he would give you living water. And so we see the second thing is that Jesus is moving this woman closer and closer to a realization of the reality of Jesus.
Are you thirsty? Are you empty? Come and drink these living water. Tired and broken, peace unspoken, rest beside these living water. Christ is calling.
Good morning to you all. Before we pray together, Rosemary and I would just like to say a very big thank you to all of you who sent us cards and greetings over the last few weeks. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
So let's pray. As we ponder on the words in John 4, Jesus is whispering to us, "If only you knew the gift God has for you, you would ask me and I would give you living water."
So Jesus, we cry out for that gift, that we might drink of your spiritual water, your Holy Spirit that brings us life. We ask that it would well up inside of us, flowing from your throne of grace into every area of our lives. Fill us to overflowing with your peace and mercy and hope.
In these uncertain days, may we learn in greater depths what it means to drink more of you. We pray for vision and discernment for our team and each one of us in our parish as we listen to your heart and the way forward. As we face changes in what church looks like, teach us to drink deep from your well of life. Whether we worship in the church building or in our homes or on a mountain, may we be a people who worship you from our hearts. May we be true worshippers.
We pray for wisdom and integrity for our leaders locally and nationally as they make decisions to bring our country safely out of lockdown. Individually, may we speak words of life to those we meet in our families, neighbourhood and our town. We declare that this day we will see the ancient wells burst forth with gushing streams of your Holy Spirit to a world crying out and thirsting for the water of life. Rivers of grace flowing through St. Austell and across our nation, living waters that bring stability where there is chaos, completeness where there is brokenness, order where there is disorder, holiness where there is unrighteousness.
We declare across this land the words of Habakkuk 2:14.
That the earth would be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, as the waters covers the sea.
Amen.
The final thing that I want us to see in this reading is that the woman was drawn ever more deeply into asking the question, "Who are you? And where can I get this living water from?" Jesus replies in verse 13, "Everyone who drinks this water," pointing to the well, "will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman has been drawn in and is now hooked into finding out more about Jesus. The reality that Jesus shows is that he is the answer to her needs. The reality we see is that the spring of life that Jesus offers actually is the spring that we are meant to become, and the woman personifies this. In verse 26, he basically says, "I am the Messiah." Jesus declared, "I who speak to you am he," after their lengthy discussion about the Messiah and his coming. Let's trace what happens in this story. There are so many threads. So at the beginning of the encounter, Jesus is unknown to the woman. I mean, this is so common, isn't it? People don't know who Jesus is. They know about the Christmas story and maybe the Easter story. But for many people, they have no idea where he came from, what he did, and what the Bible says about his return. And at the beginning of this encounter, it's just like that. This woman has no idea who this strange Jewish rabbi is, but he reveals his true self. So at the beginning of the conversation, first she saw a thirsty man, a man who just wanted a drink. Then she saw a Jew who was breaking the rules. Then she saw a rabbi. Then she saw a prophet. And then she saw the Messiah. She tried to get the better of the thirsty man by being clever and cute. She showed her deep dislike for the Jew by saying, "I'm a Samaritan and I don't really know what you're doing here." She heckled the rabbi because she had some knowledge, but she heckled him the same. And she was swept off her feet eventually by the prophet. The prophet who said, "Go and find your husband." And she says, "I have no husband." And he says, "Yeah, that's true. You've had 5 husbands." She's swept off her feet. Her defenses come down. And here we see how being a follower of Jesus is not about the book, following the book, the religion, the church. It's actually about being prophetic. It's actually about the Holy Spirit being with us and speaking to us moment by moment as we go along. And finally, having done all those things to get the better of the thirsty man, showing dislike to the Jew, heckling the rabbi, and being swept off her feet by the prophet, she finally adores the Messiah. Do you know, just earthing this in our own experience, we as a parish have bought an old pub, and we're in the process of turning that pub into a centre. It's going to be called the Trinity Centre. It's going to be a place where people can come, and no matter what they think of Jesus at the beginning, by the end of many, many conversations, maybe a whole range of conversations, we believe those people are going to realise that it's Jesus who is the reality of God, that Jesus is a real person, and he meets people through conversations, through Christians being receivers, not just tellers, through Christians who can show by their lives that there's a spring welling up within them, and that spring leads to eternal life. And there's a pattern here in this particular story, which I'd just like to draw for you. And it's this: Christians reveal Jesus as a reality when they empty themselves, not when they fill themselves with knowledge and puffed upness, but when Christians empty themselves, people see that actually we're willing to learn and be helped. The second thing is incarnation, that it's not telling just about Jesus, but it's actually being Jesus to those people in their everyday lives. The third thing is revelation. Here the prophetic is so important, that when we speak to people about their lives because God's spoken to us, when we speak truth through our own personalities, inspired by the Holy Spirit, something changes in the way that people see Jesus. So emptying ourselves, incarnation, living it, speaking prophetically, offering the water of life, which really is a symbol of the Holy Spirit, offering to pray for people to be filled with the Holy Spirit, offering to draw them in to the things of the Holy Spirit, teaching them about the Holy Spirit, and then becoming self-understanding. Do you know, one of the biggest problems for us as Christians is we're not self-aware. We don't realize how we come across. We don't always realize how other people see us. Jesus was fully aware as he went through, as he was firstly seen as a thirsty man, then a Jew, then a rabbi, then as a prophet, and lastly as a Messiah. He was seen for who he truly was. Do you know, if we could just put down our defenses and become truly who we are, talking to people and saying, "Yeah, I was like that once. Yeah, I've been into that. I've failed at this. I've made mistakes with that." It's amazing how the defenses come down. And so emptying ourselves, being incarnational, being aware that revelation opens doors, offering the water of life of the Holy Spirit, and self-understanding takes us back to emptying of ourselves. When I know where I fail, when I know that I'm not perfect, but when I know that Jesus is the Messiah, there's a deep attractiveness of self-emptying. And the church is then not accused of arrogance, but is actually called out to be revelatory. Verse 42 is an amazing verse. They said to the woman, "We no longer believe just because of what you said. Now we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Saviour of the world." Just think about what happened. The woman met Jesus as a reality. She went to her village, told them, and they then said that, "We don't just believe you, ostracized woman, woman of five husbands, bottom of the pile. We believe because you incarnated it, and then we saw it for ourselves." Do you know our Trinity Center could be like the well in Samaria, Jacob's well? Just think of Trinity Center being a well of life where people realize who Jesus is, where people drink of the water of life, which leads to eternal life, where needs are met. You know, debt is cancelled out because we help people to replan their finances, where marriages are saved because we offer a listening ear, where children are encouraged to learn more about Jesus the person, where young people are given space in a wonderful building that's made for them to learn more of who Jesus is, and most importantly, to learn more about themselves. What it means is us emptying of ourselves, of our bank accounts, maybe, of the money that we're storing up, the money that we've kept for a rainy day. Well, you know, in St. Austell, it's raining really hard at the moment. In our nation, it's raining really hard. I know it's ironic me saying this with the sun shining, but it's about emptying ourselves. It's about living it out, not just speaking it out. It's about revelation. What a revelation it would be if the town could see we renovate an old pub and it becomes a well of living water. It's about the water of the Holy Spirit really just flooding and absorbing and flowing out of everything. It's also about us becoming a church that understands ourselves, that we are people, yes, not perfect, but actually wanting to be used by God and Him wanting to use us. Which brings us back to emptying of ourselves. Yes, emptying of our purses and our wallets, but really sowing for the future. What an amazing passage this is, and you can find yourself in this passage no matter who you are. The woman at the well, the bystanders, the people who didn't believe but then heard for themselves. And also meeting Jesus as a reality. May we pray. Lord Jesus, we open our hearts and our hands to you. We open our wallets and our bank accounts to you. We open our past, our present, and our future to you. And what we seek, Lord Jesus, is a reality of Jesus. May the reality of Jesus be in the building that's going to be the Trinity Center. May it be in our homes as we pray and serve our neighborhoods. May it be in our hearts so that the Holy Spirit could be seen in us, through us, and beyond us. And we pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus, who said to that woman who was searching and thirsty, "I am He." Amen. No.
We trust that you are feeling refreshed and strengthened and uplifted by all you've experienced this morning. It has been a pleasure to worship with you. And if you have any questions, comments, or feel that we could help in any way, please feel free to use any of the means of contact that will appear on the screen. We would love to hear from you. And as we leave, let us share a blessing together. May the Lord lead you beside still waters and restore your soul. May he refresh your sense of purpose. May he renew your love for those he's given to you. And may he stir in you a hunger to know him more. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.
From heaven, this isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you. His presence go before you and behind you and beside you. Oh.